So thank you for coming. On you, I mean, as you know, we have two interesting keynotes of talk today from Monica and Wolfram. They are visiting us. And the first speaker actually is Monica Markovic, professor from the University of New Brunswick in Canada. She's the director of the People in Motion Lab and also holds the Cisco chair of Big Data. So this relationship or connection between the university and the industrial sector in this case. And as you know, basically she's visiting us this week as part of the GUC program, talking with the GUC student but also with the rest of the faculty. And the talk today is about the mobility, right? She's working now on a lot of Internet of Things, mobility analytics, streaming analysis. With this special temporal aspect is central in all of this, right? So, the floor is yours, right?
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you all for coming and being here today. And thank you, Carlos, for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here today and have this opportunity to talk about our research that we are carrying on in the People in Motion Lab. And I'm gonna try to wrap up our more recent developments and set up the stage for discussing what are the key challenges we are having today in terms of real-time streaming mobility analytics. So just to start with, what do I mean by real-time streaming mobility data? Yeah? This data is coming from Internet of Things. In our case, we are very interested on Internet of moving things. Could be cars, could be your cell phone, could be drones that will be following you or be helping you. So we are really interested in this domain. So how could I work with this data? So it has very specific characteristics. It's data that is coming in real time. It's not only the capture of the data is being carried out in real time, but also analytics. So we start to think about data flows and start thinking where to run my analytics. So to give you a concrete example, we all heard about autonomous vehicles and the industry now is really pushing Google X. Any educated guess? 50? 1,000? Yeah, and this is the source of it is that currently we have an average of 60 to 100 sensors in a car, monitoring all the engine and providing us the location of the car. But this number is projected to reach as many as 200 sensors per car in the future. And it's not too far away, this future, which will translate to approximately about 22 billion sensors used by 2020. Yeah? So what does it mean in terms of streaming? Because we are interested in real-time streaming. Is that in the very near future, one vehicle alone will produce 4 terabytes of data per hour. Can we analyze this sort of amount of huge amount of data in real time? Can I make this data available in real time? But the complexity is not even in terms of the size of the data that the cars will be producing in the future. but it's also about the communication, about of networking, and this is something that is now we call it vehicle-to-vehicle communication. This is also going to produce a large volume of data. And most of the car manufacturers at the moment, they are looking at V2V in order to make safe, in order to make driving a safer. We have an example here already, a student that perhaps in the future with autonomous cars will be, and this is expected to be the truth, that will be safer to drive autonomous cars then, and it also improved the driver experience. And there's this hype in the industry right now, and as data scientists, we are really working hard to analyze the data in order to tackle this problem that nearly almost just over 3,000 people die in road crashes every day. So this is really motivating the research in data science. Another aspect that we perhaps don't take too much into consideration is V2I. It's going to be communication between the vehicles to the infrastructure. Yeah? And USDOT, the Department of Transportation in the United States, is leading the guidelines and how these how vehicles will communicate to the infrastructure. And Google X recently provided us with these four types of main applications for vehicle-to-infrastructure communication: intersection collision warning, real-time traffic flow regulation, increased accessibility for all pedestrians, and warnings based on driver profiles. Yeah? There is an interest in the community how to analyze, how to set up the platforms, the infrastructure to be able to produce this kind of information. So this is what I mean by real-time streaming mobility data, that today we are already gathering data from V2X, which is vehicle to everything. And specifically for vehicle-to-vehicle communication and vehicle-to-infrastructure, that is already a near future data sources for real-time streaming mobility data. So let's look at the potentials. Yeah, the industry now believes that V2X will happen before autonomous cars. We've seen some cities already making some specific areas in the city reserved for autonomous vehicles. But it's expected that V2X will happen before that. And this expectation is based on 5G. This is new network technology that will provide us with the bandwidth necessary for moving this data from the cars to where they need to be analyzed. And this is something that Siemens came out about already 2 years ago with the idea that transportation will become as an utility. So when you buy a house, you buy your mobility profile. So here, I don't know, three examples that you buy your mobility package, that you have a premium parking, you have 120 minutes car sharing, and 120 minutes driver service, and you pay, for example, 300 euros a month. So depending where you work, depending where you live, you'll have different packages. So students will have more 10 days bike sharing with a 10 days weekend car sharing, would pay only 70 euros a month. Yeah? So mobility become, as we call it, mobility as a service. So technology is there. But why we are not there yet? Yeah? Because there are three main barriers for this that we have to overcome. One is continuous network coverage. Yeah? We have short, medium, and long range network coverages. Nowadays, it's a very confusing environment. there's several different types of networks. So we don't have a standard. We have three organizations, three different organizations for standards that are not reaching a consensus. So this is probably one of the that will be the most significant barrier at the moment. Security. We know, I could say that we know quite well how to do cybersecurity in the cloud. But how does it gonna be working with the security for Internet of Things? This is still, we are just at the beginning. So when we get these sensors with some processing power in the future where it's gonna be very easy to hack, how the security protocols would be. And I added this, the last one, the legacy systems in transportation, because just a couple of weeks ago, I was in Las Vegas for the first opening of the Navia autonomous bus shuttle. We were all excited, and would be the service from the airport to the street. Who know, it's a very popular street in Las Vegas, where all the casinos, hotels are there. So, but what happened? So we had a car accident. Yeah. So, and it was not a fault of the autonomous driver. Was some truck, unfortunately, cut the Navia bus and caused the accident. Fortunately, nobody was harmed, but it really shows that the legacy systems, it goes from how the infrastructure today is designed for moving cars. It goes from transportation models that we are using today are going to be obsolete, and also will be very challenging having autonomous cars with us. We are the problem, not the autonomous cars. Yeah. So what makes me now move to challenge number one? So we've been working with this sort of data. And we've been collecting data from different cars and data from communications and that's it. So we started looking at starting even asking, where is my data? In the future, you're gonna be asking, where is my data? Your data is not gonna be in your PC. Where is your data? Where is my data? Where is the data I needed? Because there is this, what I call a triangle kind of a problem here, that we are gonna have millions and billions of things smart connected, collecting data in real time, that will be moved to the cloud through a network, and until it arrives at the cloud. But then, we already know, we now have approximately 12 billion devices already, smart connected devices today, and because of this, we already know that it's going to be impossible. It's going to be impossible to move all the data through the network, get to the cloud, analyze this data, and come back with the new insights in real time. We know it's not possible. So, and there now, we need to do something about it. Yeah. So then it came the very we call this three-layer architecture for system architectures. This is not new. We always had these three layers. It's something, but the way things are going to be done is going to be different. And then at the moment we call edge computing, fog computing, and cloud computing. Meaning that you could do your pre-processing, you could do your analytics at the edge. You are gonna, and we are already doing, I'm gonna show you some examples that we are doing pre-processing and analytics at the fog inside the network. Yeah. So why I'm doing this? Because then I will sync or analyze things in the cloud when I really need more powerful processing power, when the data is already cleaned and so on. So let me give you, this is not only a software issue, but it's also a hardware. So here is one example that we did in a city in Canada, where this is what you see here. This box is a router with processing power. Yeah, it's a router with a computer in it, within office storage as well. So, and this is the size of my surface here. Yeah, today we can deploy this inside a bus, or inside a car, or any other transit mode. And this box here contains GPS, contains an accelerometer, it contains any other kind of sensor that you are interested in. But this box also can collect the telemetry data from the bus. Telemetry data is the sensors that are put on a bus to know about the engine, to know about how the drivers are driving. So this is my edge node physically. So it's not just a software problem, it's a hardware. We need this kind of hardware. So once I collect the data in real time, I have the software architecture, the system architecture here. I have an operating system, and I don't have too much memory here. So I can do very basic descriptive analytics, very basic cleaning tasks here. And then later, I can move the data to the fog node. And in my case, here is also an example of a fog node there, where I can do more complex analytics and other things there. So in there, we can install these on inside a building, or in this case, is in the transit hub. So this is really creating a pervasive IoT environment for analytics that we never had before. Yeah, we always collected the whole data, put it in a cloud, and then start doing our analytics. So that goes for where is my data. So another very important challenge we faced this year with this the experiments we ran was about how to manage the data flow. Yeah, in the future we want the data that we needed in real time, but when should I move the data from the edge, from my edge node, which is in the bus, to the fog and to the cloud? Yes, it will be based on network connectivity. It's going to be based on bandwidth. But it should also be based on when do I need the data for the analytics. And this is something that, especially in geospatial context, we never really worried about it. And, people more, scientists working more on wireless sensor networks and other domains, they've been already thinking about this. But for us, we will start to see where is my data, it's in motion, when do I need my data, and when data is at rest. So I'm going to try to explain here very simply, because I focus more on real time. What is this about streaming? Streaming is, the name might be misleading, because you might think that it's going to be like a river, right? It's streaming. It's a flow. But data is still discrete. Yeah? So what we are going to have, you can see like tuples that are being streamed, but still is a discrete fact. So when we say streaming, it's not that I'm going to be, I still have to create time windows. So I have to create a time window that I can define the time window in terms of I want to retrieve the data every 5 seconds. I want to retrieve data when I have 1 billion tuples. It could be based on size, could be based on the location. But I still have to create this time window where I retrieve the data, which is streaming in the network, and then work in memory. our, and that's the most challenge right now, because majority, 99% of our algorithms have been developed for batch processing, have not been developed for streaming data. So there is no time to store this data. There is no time to index this data. So our algorithms, that we have to change them, because now they have to work in memory. So when I've done use this data for the analytics, got the new insights, is then I'm going to store it in disk. So then I call it data at rest. And we are going to do this over and over again, create another time window, analyzed, and so on. So this is what I mean by streaming. But unfortunately, it's not that easy to do that in practice. We spend a year already working on this, and that's the best architecture we found at the moment from, we call it cloud to things, or things to cloud architecture, where we have all the devices here, the sensors here, an architecture that allows you to use any kind of connectivity, Wi-Fi, Zigbee, LoRaWAN, create these data packages. You can imagine this as data windows here, and then have to develop these message brokers that can make the communication between a fog node to an edge node to work. So it's a huge problem. It's not easy to do it. In the fog node, we are now testing a platform developed by Cisco, but in fact we have over 400 platforms already proposed for this. So let me give you an example. So as I mentioned, we are doing this with the buses, and here is just now. For example, we streamed 65 million tuples from June 2016 to May 2017. And here's just an example of the kind of attribute data we have. So we start cleaning at the edge, because you're going to be surprised how IoT data, it's really, there's lots of noise. There's lots of duplications and missing values. So cleaning really becomes an issue here. So we clean this data, and then when we move to the fog, we move just 38.5 million tuples from the 65 million. Just to show the magnitude how cleaning becomes a very important. Here is just to give you an idea about at least the user interface we are developing at the moment, that will be a kind of a linear programming kind of idea here, each block performing a particular task that could be data acquisition, processing, sorting, cleaning, monitoring. So this tries to help us to manage the data flow. So when we done all the tasks and this is performed, we move to the cloud. And then at the cloud, only 26.5 million tuples out of the 38.5 I had at the fog that really arrived there. So this saves bandwidth, this saves time to us. So challenge number three is, can we do really analytics everywhere? This is my main, at the moment, is my research premise, that we will be able to do analytics at the edge, fog, and cloud computing. But how this would really work, I have to admit, I do not know yet. We've been thinking, for example, you might be interested in clustering. So I'm going to be doing clustering here, there, and there. I know, for example, I cannot do perhaps machine learning here, but in the cloud, I might be able to do it. Can we really gonna pull out this analytics everywhere? And this is what we really hope so. And at the moment, what we are thinking is not, we started thinking about the methods, clustering, machine learning, and then at a certain point, a couple of months ago, we decided to stop thinking about the methods, yeah? No matter what method you might be able to run here in the network, fog, or in the cloud, start thinking about what is your question, what do you want from the data? And then things started about to really, it was a kind of aha moment for us, because we started thinking, well, at the edge, we can really tell in real time what is happening. In the fog, we might be able to tell why is happening. And then in the cloud, I will then predict what is more likely to happen. Yeah? So we moved away from thinking, mainly because we tested several algorithms for clustering, for association, for rule-based things, and then at the end we stopped and said, if we follow this, we might be able to really reach where we want to be. But it's really would be, we are looking for an application, we are looking out to see if we can really demonstrate this in practice. We mm-hmm. just finished a paper on this for a special issue on future systems. So hopefully you will hear more from this part. But before, just to give you this, we already published, is that we created this idea of mobility neighborhoods. So it's a predefined radius around any mobile thing at any given point in time. Any other thing within the predefined radius around a mobile thing is a neighbor to this mobile thing. Everybody understood? Yeah? Has anybody, everybody understood? Of course not. Yeah? We try to define as much as better as possible, but you know, a figure is much easier. So what is this mobility neighborhoods? Imagine now that I have my cars moving on a highway. Yeah? So, and for each car, I'm gonna create this mobility neighborhood. So for the sake of the example here, it will be car number four. And then car number four, I will create, I'm interested in a 15 meter mobility neighborhood. So then creating this mobility neighborhood, I will know that 2, 3, and 5 are moving close to car number four. And I can have another mobility radius. So a 50 meter mobility radius, for example, and then I will have more other cars that would be moving within this mobility neighborhood. And we create a mobility neighborhood for each car. And we create this mobility neighborhood in real time for each car. So then was the question, how can I analyze this data? So we started recognizing proximity and mobility as a graph problem. We moved away from the GIS layer structure for working with bipartite graphs. Bipartite graphs are very interesting graphs because there are only two sets of nodes here, mobility neighborhoods and mobile things, in our case are the cars. And every time we create an edge, it's because this this car over here is inside of that mobility neighborhood, and that mobility neighborhood. And this is very fast to compute. It's possible to compute in real time. So then we thought, well, we got the data, I've got my mobility neighborhoods, and what kind of method can I use? And we tested several clustering algorithms on graphs, and Louvain clustering, for some people, we call it Louvain community detection, was the one that performed the best, the fastest one, and we could compute the modularity about the clusters using Louvain's modularity equation function. So I don't gonna go into much detail, but here the important thing is to know that then we could have a measure, a metric that tells me minus one or plus one. Plus one is that all these cars become a cluster because they are moving with a similar speed or with a similar distance between each other. And minus one would be the opposite. We test that with a vehicle data set. So we had this vehicle trajectory data. We transformed to bipartite graphs, but basically it's a 600 meter strip of highway 101 near Saint-Closet, where and we collected the data for the location of every vehicle every decisecond. We had approximately 15 minutes of data, and here is just an idea from the attributes from telemetry data in X and Y position. Just to give a visual idea how this bipartite become, this is just for one decisecond, how the graph looks like. Yeah, so it's very dense. We have at the bottom the cars, and at the top we have the mobility neighborhoods. You can see that the connectivity is always between one set to another set. There is never a connectivity between the nodes. So here are the results. So we create this animation here where you can see the cars coming in into the highway, and the algorithm is running in real time, showing different clusters. The algorithm is not a fixed number, it's a supervised clustering mechanism that you can have three communities, three or five or six clusters, and you see this, how this evolves within the data. So we computed in 15 minutes 5,000 clusters. The maximum number of maximum number of clusters in one would be 9, and minimum number of clusters would be 2, but this 2 is just because it was the beginning of the data. Another interesting thing might be that we found clusters with up to 52 cars in a cluster. So you might be thinking now, okay, Monica, nice, you're proving you're doing something in real time, but what are you gonna use? This use of these mobility neighborhoods is really to manage the V2X communication. Yeah? When my mobility neighborhood intersects or overlaps with your mobility neighborhood, we know there will be an interaction. And we hope that this interaction then we will be able to deploy without human intervention. But we also create these mobility neighborhoods because it's going to become as like a filter for real-time mobility analytics at both edge and fog nodes. Yeah? So I'm not going to send data just based on their size or based on temporal. I'm going to be moving data around the network based on mobility neighborhoods. How many mobility neighborhoods do I need and what for? So why are you using bipartite graphs? We are not using just bipartite graphs. We are testing other types of graphs, directed, undirected, cyclic graphs. This is also showing some promising results. But the main idea of using graphs is because we can create a scalable analytical framework. If I am at the edge, I start creating the nodes and links. Yeah, at the fog, I will create the subgraphs, and at the cloud, I will create the whole network. This is very scalable, and we start thinking about mobility in terms of connectivity. This is the paper from from there from Mexico. If you are interested in starting to understand how this V2X and vehicle-to-vehicle, vehicle-to-infrastructure, vehicle-to-road devices, and then vehicle-to-personal devices, this paper really provides an interesting introduction. Conclusions. Where are we now? What are we going to be doing for the next year? Well, we want to understand more the heterogeneity of requirements. So we've been working with the same data rate. We've been working with the same type of IoT device. So in the future, we are going to start mixing different data sources, different devices. So this will even increase more challenges in terms of how we are going to handle the data flow, challenge number two. So we are going to have data arriving with very low data rate mixed up with data with high data rate. So how we are going to fix this? At the moment we focused only on the cars, so we are going to be moving to how fixed things to mobile things. And one thing that already is being an issue for us is power. Yeah, sometimes my analytics consumes. You can see when you have a GPS on your mobile device, it consumes more power. So power is becoming an issue for real time analytics. This is something that we are going to be keeping an eye on it, because if you go to any wireless technologies today, Zigbee, Bluetooth, or LoRaWAN, all these guys here, they all promise to be compatible to the IoT. They all are promising this, but not necessarily. That's not really the case. And it's very volatile at the moment. We really do not know what is going to happen in this sector. So we have to be careful because of the network technology, at least for short and medium range, will change dramatically in a couple of years. Now, some conclusions in terms of more in terms of GIS geotechnologies. This heterogeneity of devices, the heterogeneity of IoT, is going to mean to us that there will not have one GIS technology that can fit everything, all the needs. Yeah, we've been working with one GIS, and we could do all sorts of analytics, all sorts of applications, but I've foreseen an issue there. Perhaps fog computing is something new in the geospatial technology community, but I can guarantee to you that you're going to be hearing more and more about fog computing, how to cloud to things. I think this you will be seeing more and more papers coming up in the future. And here is just an interesting thing that happened, because if one GIS doesn't fit anything, what will happen to GIS, right? So I've been looking at this, and I came across three papers Goodchild published in 1998, I think, and where he was claiming the need for a measurement-based GIS. And as a matter of fact, when I read these three sequential papers, it was very interesting the conceptualization that Goodchild had at the time, 1998, because I think it's the precursor of, instead of measurement, I would put IoT-based GIS. So several ideas that I found in these articles, I'm starting to look at it. So thank you very much, and if you have any questions, I would be glad to answer. Thank you for your attention.
Yeah. Okay. Any question for the audience? Yes.
Yeah, sure.
So for that road data that you had, were those sensors within cars that you were tracking somehow, or was it remote sensing?
No, no, was from video cameras. Yeah, from video cameras. Because now, and this is also, we don't have, I needed to know all the location of all vehicles. Yeah, some companies already have, and yeah, but no, it was from a video camera. Trying to simulate what would look like a V2 to be in the future.
Would it make sense to how do you call them, motion circles?
Yeah, mobility neighborhoods.
Would it make sense to virtualize those as well? That's,
yeah.
For example, I want all the red cars.
Yeah, yeah.
Instead of the ones around me.
Yeah, it would, yeah. And the other thing we are also thinking that it shouldn't be that a fixed radius, that it should be dynamic. If you're moving faster, the radius will be larger than if you're moving slower. Yeah, so there are all these different possibilities there. And recently when a student of Kane presented this in Vancouver a couple of weeks ago, someone also gave the idea of not using a circle, but using a kind of a band, a buffer, so replicating the lanes. So yeah, but it is definitely a way of working in the future, definitely.
Maybe it's also dynamic based on the environment.
Yeah, because also dynamic based on the environment.
Because maybe there are obstacles and maybe something is just 2 meters, but there is no interaction.
Yeah.
There is no.
Yeah, we I don't think so we're going to be able to do, we're still going to keep on the highway, because downtown urban areas is going to be the interaction between something static, like
yeah.
If we are going to have traffic lights in the future, I do not know, but still interaction between the car and some road signs or even people, right?
Yeah, or people in apartment blocks, like,
yeah.
You don't want to be connecting with people on the fifth floor if
exactly.
You're passing
with a
car.
Exactly, yeah. But it has been very positive in terms of trying to organize the data, transform the data in a way that we can run more efficiently the analytics. Yeah, sure.
You mentioned something like a few months ago regarding downtown. I was going to ask about
mm-hmm.
this environment because it looks like this is a very car-centric approach. So this Internet of Things looks like Internet of Cars. But what about these areas where mobility is not based on cars? Like
yeah, we are using the Internet of Vehicles because this is probably the first sector where we are going to be really having the real data, real world data very soon, probably a couple of years. But yes, you are right. Other mobility of other objects, people, pedestrians, bikes, that would be also the in the future. It's just because we had to select a sector where we could see not in a 5 year time or 10 year time that we would be able to have real-time streaming mobility data, so vehicles is, and even a couple of days ago on the news was already that they are talking about the autonomous vehicles. Yeah, some cities are already closing some areas, like in Toronto, for example, an area which was completely abandoned near the port area in Toronto. Now, specific areas where you have network coverage, everything works as we should be working in the future. The main challenge for V2I, that's why it has been so slow, is because it requires the cities to invest in this infrastructure. Yeah, and the cities are not prepared to invest in this infrastructure. They always say they have more important things, and it's true. So that's why companies like Google are also trying to make this themselves, make this kind of environments to lead the way. Yeah.
Do you have any idea about the sensor that would be like driving this? Because in cars we already have sensors, so it is somehow easy to plug them into the network. But what about some other, like humans or bikes or other modes of transportation, about sensors here?
Yes, we do have it. For pedestrians, for example, we look at wearables, very popular at the moment. The main problem with wearables for us has been that it's a very passive, and there's not power, computing power there, and it's very messy to try to do our edge analytics with wearables. They are promising, the companies involved in wearable computing, they are promising to improve this, and the main applications will be on health. There is an internet they call it health IoT, that is really looking for improving the wearables, improving the sensors to be able to provide us with that. But yes, it is. It's gonna be, and some, I should also, I forgot to mention, because sometimes people really think there would be this misconception that it's gonna be one Internet of Things, this one thing, but in fact, no. We are gonna have, I cannot really predict, but it's gonna be a large number, hundreds of thousands or even billions of Internet of Things, right? So it's not only, we call it Internet of Things nowadays, but in the things we are already doing today is already showing that you have Internet of Vehicles, Internet of Industrial Things, and they have different behaviors, and they have different needs of analytics. So things will be different, yeah, according to what things you are connecting. Yeah?
I have two confusions regarding issues in fog computing.
Yeah.
So once we ascend data from a thing to the network and we start computing in the network, doesn't it brings more latency, because while you do fog computing, maybe it is less powerful than the cloud, and it takes some more time to, naturally it takes some more time to compute, and wouldn't it make it things more slow?
I always have this question. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. I always, when I present, I have this question. So my answer is that we have to rethink things again. I'm not saying that I'm going to, when we are doing the things in the cloud, we are going to continue to do things in the cloud. But there are other things that we can do that I don't need the cloud for. I can do it in fog computing. I'm not saying that fog will be, I know some advertisements might be misleading, saying the fog will replace the cloud. I've seen already some articles like this. I don't agree with this. Each one of these levels will have a purpose. So if the cloud is doing what I need to do it fast enough and doing things it should be, it's gonna be the cloud. But we know that that's not going to be the case, especially for smart mobility. It's not going to be the case. Some pre-steps on them on the fog. Yeah, but I'm not. One is not better than the other. One is not going to replace the other. Things will be that if they both work at the same, they work for a common purpose. That's the best strategy. Yeah. And I have the same questions when I present this from the IoT community that say, and then also say, I want to do everything at the edge, Monica. And then I always say, well, edge will also be depend, it will depend on where is this edge. Yeah. When I talk about edge, it's for networking engineers, they understand immediately what edge is for them. It's the gateway. But if I talk to an IoT community, they think the edge is something like my edge node from Cisco, or they think about is a sync in on the wireless sensor network. So there is a confusion about terminology, but as far as we understand this, not that is a complexity issue, that is just that you are gathering data and trying to do is descriptive analytic, maybe prescriptive analytics in the fog, and then maybe communicate to each other would be great.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, one question.
Yes, Bruce.
Well, I'm not sure I really understood the concept of neighborhood.
Yeah.
This is a logical concept, right?
Pardon?
It's a logical concept.
It's a logical, yeah. It is a logical.
So
it's,
let's say that the entities that are in this neighborhood are built on the fog computing layer, let's say.
The analytics, yeah. This was built on there, yeah.
Yeah, and this layer is composed by several devices. With their own storage and their own power, computing power.
Yeah.
So, isn't this analytic data limited by the data accessible by this device? So that things that at a higher level that requires like high level aggregation on those data wouldn't be possible on those at that level.
Well, if I understood correctly, I'm having trouble to understand you, but analytics will always depend on the data, no matter where you are, fog, edge, cloud. Even with you have a cloud, I have recently, the client gave us a large data set, a huge data set, thinking, go and analyze it. And then when we analyzed, we detected, because of the analytics, we detected that several sensors were not transmitting the data to the cloud. Yeah. So this, you're going to have this trouble in the cloud or in the fog or wherever you're going to be doing the analytics. And the second part of the question is, I think you asked me, can you repeat it again? Because I had trouble to...
Yeah, it was the first one was about if the method, I think the second one was about this, if those methods for analyzing the data wouldn't be limited at that level, the level of fog computer.
I need, in terms of limitation, I cannot really answer that right now because we haven't run enough analytics or carried with our experiments in for a longer period as well. So I really cannot really tell about the limitations in terms of analytics. You've seen that all my limitations are more in terms of technology. I don't have yet a view for the analytics. Just give me a year, because we've been doing lots of analytics now.
Okay.
Connected with me in a year time, I might have an answer for that. Whatever I will say here would be just speculation.
Okay.
Yeah, no, it's not easy. It's a very difficult question. Thank you for that. Yeah, you spotted right on. Yeah,
I mean,
the
last one, right? Yeah, you can follow the discussion.
We
right
have
there.
Another
right.
Speaker
well.
Coming. Yeah.
Hey, just a final comment on
sure.
your questions about the role of GIS and this stuff.
Yeah.
Don't you think that this is already diluted there because we are already solving geographical problems with IoT? The main example could be the intersection. There is a geographical space, and then you are deciding to do something in this geographical space, and then you don't need to go to the traditional view of the desktop GIS and the map. Okay. So I would say that this concept is already diluted.
Yeah. It's kind of I'm putting a project proposal together. Is that mapping for machine learning? How we're going to create maps, not for humans, but for machines. So I don't know the answer to that question as well. So hopefully we'll have to look at, because maps in the future GIS will not be only for humans, right?
Okay, thank you very much.